I'm Dr. Woody. I'm here with Michael Furtick, founder and CEO of Reputation.com. So, Michael, good to have you here.
Thank you.
And so, tell me a little bit about Reputation.com and where this idea came from.
We protect reputation and privacy on the internet. Our idea is to invert the current business model of the internet, which is basically to take your data without your knowledge or permission, sell it to people you cannot identify for purposes you can never know.
Right, right.
And if we were building this internet from the ground up, we wouldn't build it that way.
Sure.
We wouldn't build it to be a big advertising engine. Instead, our mission is to give you control over your data so you can monetize it the way you want to and make you the atomic central unit of the internet again.
But what is it about you as an individual looking out there and seeing what you described, this model, that frustrated you and said, I got to do something about it?
I didn't think that we were, as humans, supposed to be the objects of the sentence on the internet. We weren't supposed to be kind of victims of the machine.
I thought
we should be the subject and the verb of the sentence with the internet. And so one of the common sort of statements, but also mythical statements of the internet, is that you are the center of the internet. Turns out the advertising company is. And so, by the way, it's not hard to fix this. If you ask the guys who invented the internet, they would say that they messed up in not creating something called the authentication layer of the internet, which would put you at the center of your control of your data. And that's what we're trying to do. We're putting you in the control of the driver's seat of your digital DNA.
And so when you had the idea, then you had to take it and turn it into a business.
Yes.
And go into being that entrepreneur. But then, of course, now, it's a full-blown organization.
Yes.
So how has that journey been for you, going from idea to entrepreneur to now a business leader?
Well, I mean, I have to reinvent myself, right? I mean,
sure.
I think I'm kind of in CEO 3.0, right? And that means that I have to upgrade my game. I have to upgrade my colleagues, and they have to upgrade my game. And I also have to make sure that I'm constantly learning from people, you can call them mentors or rabbis, mm-hmm. or your board members, who mm-hmm. can make sure that you're not just an entrepreneur, not just an entrepreneurial CEO, but an actual CEO.
As an entrepreneur, when you had this idea, yeah. and you went out there to the world and decided to create a business out of it,
uh-huh.
what were some of the first initial challenges in really taking that idea and bringing it to fruition?
Well, the challenges are everything from execution to conception to inception. So there are two kinds of internet companies. One is faster, better, cheaper. So mm. There's a market,
sure.
and you're going to do it better than the other guy. And the other is Brave New World. We're going to do something that no one's ever done before. And this is a Brave New World kind of company. So you have to have conviction that you're right. You have to make
right.
sure that the market timing is correct.
Sure.
And you have to build the right product for the right market fit.
And so what is it about you then, as an individual? Yeah, this is where I get the psychologist part coming at you. But that was able to reach in yourself and have the courage to do this, but also figure out what is it about you that you want reflected in this organization and the people that you bring on board?
So I've been an entrepreneur for a long time. I'm 35. I started my first company when I was 19. And so I think that the entrepreneurship bug is in me. But I'll tell you, in this company at this time, we talk about a few of our religions, our religious principles.
Okay.
Which aren't tied to any one religion or another, but they're the things that you can call core values or core ideas that permeate the culture of the company. And we're very open about them. Number one, we don't talk about market share. So
okay.
we spend our time running our race. We're aware of the competition, but one of the few times I'll pipe up in a meeting is when I hear people talking too much about market share. Number two, we have a free market system, which means that if you are dominating your job, if you're kicking ass, we'll give you more and more responsibility. But we're not going to bring you along that path. You really have to step up and raise your hand.
Okay.
Every CEO would probably say that they like a kind of self-starting culture,
sure.
but we mean it. Three, we talk about telling the truth all the time under every circumstance. What that means is that you shouldn't obviously directly deceive anyone, but nor should you ever engage in what we call polite deception. If
yeah.
someone's got something that's a kind of a bad idea, including me,
uh-huh.
then you owe it to us to say so. You can say it with
right.
kindness and
right.
with humor,
right.
but
right.
you have to say it. And another one I'd offer, which I think might be of interest, is we insist on positive energy. We're not a negative Nelly organization.
Sure.
So everyone's got a bad day. Everyone's got, from time to time, a down day. That happens. I have them. The other guys have them. The other gals have them. But if you become an Eeyore or a
mm-hmm.
toxic
mm-hmm.
person,
uh-huh.
you're immediately out of our company. Just can't sustain it.
So, but where do these come from? I mean, where did you pick these up along the way prior to launching this business and as you've evolved as an executive?
Well, I think I was both intentional and accidental about them, to be
okay.
telling you the truth.
Okay.
I think that I came to understand that, so I'm definitely a positive energy person, so I can't
mm-hmm.
stand being around negative energy.
Mm-hmm.
When you're trying to do something very hard, like entrepreneurship, you have to insist on positive energy. But as to whether you're free market or the other thing, I think it's sometimes it's a fit for what your company's doing. If your company's doing something new, then you need extra self-starting something quality. If you're doing something that's a strong execution play in a mm-hmm. faster, better, cheaper kind of company, mm-hmm. well, then you just may need people who are fast, 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 not necessarily people who are self-starting. So there's both a intentionality and an observation about both myself and about what we were doing that led me to these principles.
And now, how do you take these principles and make sure that everyone really adheres to them, or at least they believe and buy into them? Because it's one thing for you to have them, right? And project them out there, but it's another thing for others to really come on board with it.
So I used to interview everybody. I now interview almost everybody. And one of the things that I do in the interview is, by the time they've gotten to me, usually a skill set's there and so forth, and I'm interviewing for cultural fit.
Yep.
And I usually try to tell them why they should not work there.
Okay.
Why not work here. I usually try to say, look, here are the reasons you can work here.
Right.
If you like these ideas, and if you don't, then there are many great places for you. And I try to be very honest on our advertising about who we are. We're not an especially strong coaching company.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
You're either rising or you're getting some attention to coaching, but we're not a strong coaching company. I think there are many wonderful companies that do that very well. We instead are focusing on people who are raising their hand and going after it. And that's an openly and advertised feature of our business. And if you like it, if you fit, then this is a great place for you.
Sure.
If not, then you can tell us that too.
Well, thank you so much for taking the time to stop by. I really appreciate it. This
My
is
pleasure.
Really good stuff.
My pleasure.